Hi, everybody. My name is Peter Luongo, and it's my pleasure to continue a discussion that we started at Believe in Music Week in January around ukulele instruction. And it is a great opportunity for us to have you come and join in a discussion about teaching and learning to play the uke. You can be part of a growing movement to utilize the ukulele to gain music literacy, develop musicianship, and engage in music making for learners of all ages. And with that said, the first of our five sessions this morning, it gives me great, great privilege and honor to be able to introduce you to Chalmers Doane and Melanie Doane. I'm going to welcome them into the studio at this time. Good morning, guys. Hey, Chalmers.
Good morning.
You know, I just want the audience to know, Chalmers was the music supervisor for the Halifax City Schools through the 60s, 70s, and 80s. He created a groundbreaking program with one of the main innovations being the use of the ukulele in the classroom. It was one component of a bigger program right throughout that district. He is a recipient of the Order of Canada, which is the second greatest honor that you can have in Canada, and it recognizes outstanding achievement, dedication to the community, and service to the nation. He's worked closely with James Hill in the development of ukulele in the classroom program, materials, and it's an extension of a program that he started 50 years ago. Chalmers has been my ukulele mentor, inspiration teacher, and friend for 40 years. Our families will forever be linked across the country with the ukulele. Melanie is a Juno Award nominee, multiple top 40 singles, gold albums, a Broadway run, and thousands of shows in Canada and the US. These are just a few of the highlights in Melanie's long career. 9 years ago, Melanie added another dimension to her work. She created a school music program which would carry on the work started by her dad. Doane U School is now a registered charity serving 900 children each week in 55 schools. Now, we're going to get started. We're going to let some pictures paint the words for you. Melanie, we've got this great clip that you sent us. Why don't you set it up?
Sure. Great to see you, Peter. Hey, Dad.
How are you doing?
Doing well. Here's a little clip of some kids in my program, a small number of them, doing a song we did just as the pandemic hit. We had one of our stars here in Canada called Jan Arden, who people know, and she agreed to perform with the kids. And it was a chance to showcase their abilities, what they've been learning in class, and a chance to do a great song with someone awesome like Jan Arden. So here it is.
If you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, you're going the wrong way. You've got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, just shine your light for everyone to see. And if you try a little kindness, then you'll overlook the blindness of a broken heart of people on their broken heart of streets.
Hey! Let's show them what you can do, guys.
Don't you walk around down the mountain.
Ah, that's fantastic. Well done. Way to go. Mel, how many kids have you got involved in the program?
We started with 9 and now it's 900. So just like when I was a kid in Halifax, it grew and it grew and it grew, and it's keeping us busy. But it's a great ride.
And what great energy too. Fantastic. Well, listen, we're going to talk to you more later. Tell us a little bit about the sorts of things that you're using in the program and how you use the ukulele.
Well, I'm really standing on the shoulders, of course, of my dad and music educators like you, Peter, who did so much work in this country. And of course, I was a kid who was a beneficiary of this. I grew up in the program, but the crux of it, and the thing I like to tell music teachers or ukulele players who maybe don't realize some of the potential, is that Dad, and I'm going to talk about you, but I know you're going to get a chance in a minute. The big idea was, well, yeah, we love having a few fun chords on our ukulele and the kids can sing and strum, but what about the stuff we give them on all the other instruments? And this is what he did, was create a real instrumental program using a very accessible and affordable instrument. And so he started with melody, which is our scales, and then started to do the harmony and the melody. So the melody and harmony together, so amazing. Can't do that on every instrument. So that was already, well, this is a huge bonus. We can do melody and harmony. I know I'm talking for you, Dad. I'm pretending I'm you. And so then what about this other component, the rhythm? We didn't even get to that yet, but rhythm, the, you know, so important. And putting all three together, we can do that on the ukulele.
You know, Chalmers, that's just a younger, prettier model of you right there, right there. Yeah. I love it. What a wonderful legacy.
And, you know, that doesn't even get into the fact that you can sing and play. So, of course, these are all huge advantages when you're a teacher. And he just ran with those. And, you know, I'll let you tell that story better, Dad. But that's the part that I marvel at, because it is a real instrument. We can do all of the real stuff. And that's the message to the teachers, is don't miss the chance to do all of the real stuff, because you can. The sky's the limit.
What a powerful message. Chalmers, what prompted all of this? Where did the idea to use the ukulele come from for you to then employ it, as you did, in the music department in Halifax?
Well, my mother played some ukulele, and I have a picture of her on a beach with a ukulele about 1923. Wow. And I was born about 10 years later, and by the time I was four, she had given me a ukulele. I had a very cheap plastic ukulele, but it was a ukulele. And she knew one or two chords, maybe three even, and she showed me how to get started on it. And we also had a George Formby record in the house. Dad had bought us a record player. So I listened to that. I liked that very much. And matter of fact, I wore that record pretty well out. we only had the one. But anyway, to jump ahead a little bit, toward this time, when I was young, I was really very interested in music, and I started piano lessons right about the same time, 40, early 40s. And I took piano lessons for 10 years, and I learned a bit about the piano. I wasn't that good a student, but I was learning how to play. And anyway, little by little, I started to do different things. I got interested in multiple recording, and I started doing that in the 50s with two tape recorders. And then I had a band. My first little band was grade six, and I had several ukuleles in it, banjo ukuleles, and we actually played for the Kiwanis Club, and they gave us a meal. So that was the first pay job.
I love it.
And anyway, as time went on, I did more and more of that sort of thing. But I was also playing in the town band. And as I grew into my teens, I eventually was conducting that band for the Toro Concert Band. So I was involved with music. The ukulele was just something that I used to play all the time, but I didn't, teach too many people. The kids on our street learned to play with me a little bit, but that's sort of the way it went. But anyway, little by little, I kept doing it, and I eventually had a dance band, and we traveled all around in Nova Scotia doing the school proms and these things, and I did a lot of stuff like that. I played a bunch of different instruments. So anyway, trying to stay on the subject of the ukulele. When I got to taking a course to become a music teacher, I ended up in a school teaching music. And so I took the ukulele, and that was one instrument. I started a school band, and I had a string group, and I had a recorder ensemble, and a girls' double quartet, and a guys' quartet, and all these things. But the ukulele stayed going, and I'm leading up to one little thing that happened. We ended up on television doing a program in Nova Scotia that was quite popular. And a couple of days after that, I was there early in the morning. One little kid used to come early in the morning, Dwight Ashley, because he came on the milk truck. And I said, "What'd you think of that, what we did the other night?" And he said, "Oh, that was okay." And I said, "Was it just okay? Wasn't it better than that?" And he said, "Well, it was good." And he was walking around my room here about 7:30 or something in the morning. And he turned to me and he said, "When are you going to teach us how to play?" Wow. And I said, "Well, what do you mean? We're already playing. We're strumming and you're playing." No, he says, "I don't mean that. I mean play." And what he meant was, when am I going to teach him how to play? He wanted melody. And I mean, this really let the air out of my balloon. Because when I got home, I told my wife that this young kid had called me on my whole philosophy and my whole career, my whole everything.
Wow.
And I said, "I've either got to stop this or start and do it right." Mm. Because he was totally right. That's what he wanted. And wow. So then I started teaching them to play scales and any song that they wanted to learn to play. If they wanted to play O Canada, it's there. This instrument can play everything, all the melody, all the harmony, and the rhythm. All the three things, the three main components of music. So that started me on a whole new thing, and I decided that I better write a book on this and get the thing serious. So that, along with my band program and teaching all the grades from grade 7 to grade 12, most of them twice a week. It was a very busy program. But anyway, that's what I was doing out in the country. Then I decided that I had to get some more education because it was going well, but I didn't really know anything yet. And I decided that what I really needed to do was get a degree in music. So I started applying places. We ended up in Boston at Boston University. Wow. Where they had a good program for music education. And I signed up for almost every instrument known to man, including oboe, bassoon, French horn, trumpet, trombone, sax, clarinet, and functional piano. They had a course on that going there. And then I took conducting and, of course, theory and harmony and history and all those different things. So I did that for a few years until I got my degree. And that was really exciting. And all the time up there, if we went on a football trip, which I did, I played in a marching band and did all that stuff. I would take my uke, and I would have the whole bus going, playing music because of this uke. And people were very interested in it, but I wasn't trying to teach anybody how to play. I was just showing off and playing the uke and having some fun. Anyway, eventually, time passed. I'm going fast here now, and I was offered a job in Halifax to be the director of the music program. In the city, it was first they hired me as instrumental And that's a big, long story, so I'm going to skip that. We'll tell you about that sometime, maybe. But I ended up being in charge of the whole music program. And I had heard the Lawrence Park Collegiate Symphony Orchestra, and they were unbelievable. I couldn't believe how some young kids could play like that. And I decided right there that I had to have one of those. And so I started working on building a full band program, a full instrumental program, including violin, viola, cello, and bass, and all of the wind instruments, and started our thing with going toward an orchestra. Well, we did that, and it took, anyway, I'm going to jump ahead now a few years. I've got a bunch of kids playing violin, cello, and viola, bass, and all those, and I've got the French horns and all that kind of thing, but there were kids that slipped through the cracks in the program. They didn't have the setup at home for practicing an instrument and doing things. And so I decided to start teaching the ukulele in a very systematic way as well. So we offered ukulele, and this was done on an interest basis and so on. So anyway, that was sort of the beginning of the ukulele program in the schools in Halifax.
Wow. You know, the whole notion that you've taken all that background in music education, that you took all of that other training and applied it then to the ukulele and to having that as be part of the program is absolutely amazing. The way that you've described it is perfect. Chalmers, what role, if I could ask it this way, what role did playing the ukulele have in terms of then preparing kids for other elements of that program? Because I know that it ultimately led to this huge production that you would put on every year at the local hockey rink that was massive. And again, the uke was a small component of it, but it must have had a role in terms of setting up the rest of it for success.
Well, there were a number of things that I began to bring into music education. And the ukulele was one of them. And we had all these different ensembles, and we were heading toward the orchestra, of course, and we had the band program going and so on. But I guess what I wanted to say was we offered the ukulele at all different levels. And after the kids worked for a while, they could audition for the next level. And the final goal was to get in the A group. And that was a very good thing as far as the ukulele. But just to compare it a little bit with the rest of the program, one thing, people love to do comparisons. And my father always used to say comparisons are odious. However, people want to do that all the time. And they would say to me, and people would say, well, which do you think is better, a violin or a ukulele? And I said, every violinist would play a heck of a lot better if they also played the ukulele. And I believe that because of the rhythm and the personal things that you do with the ukulele that you might not do with a violin. You're not going to just take a violin everywhere with you, but you can take a ukulele everywhere with you pretty well.
And so, not to mention the singing. A lot of violinists don't sing enough, so I'm just going to say. I play both. So.
This is absolutely true. Yeah. And this is another thing which comes into my philosophy, which I know you didn't ask about, but people talk about teaching singing.
Yeah.
Teaching singing is the same. You learn to sing the same way you learn to talk. People don't understand this. Whistling and talking, singing, are almost the same thing. If you were monotonic and you talk like this, that would be different. But we don't know very many people. You see it on television occasionally, but we don't know anybody that speaks monotonically because it's ups and downs and shorts and longs and loud and soft. This is the basis of music. And so all of that thrown into the uke program, and you throw that into every aspect of music education. So the uke program grew, and we started to have a little bit of success with it. So I decided to make a recording with the kids. So I made 100 records And yeah, Melanie's holding something
yep.
up there.
Yep.
That we did about 10 recordings, but this first one.
That wasn't the first one. But I haven't.
No, that wasn't the first one. But we did a recording, and I gave each kid 5 records and sent them out to sell it to their parents. That was the idea. A radio guy in Dartmouth heard it, started pushing it, and he played it every morning on CFDR radio, and he was excited by it, and I mean every morning.
Yeah.
And we were out of records in about 4 days. We didn't have any more. So I went back to them and I said, make me 1,000. And so they made me 1,000 records, and we started selling records. And we did a number of records, and we didn't have any trouble selling them. And we didn't have pantry sales, and we didn't have all that other stuff. Our program did a lot of its financing of extras with what we made with our own music making.
Yeah.
And that was really important. So anyway, that was not exactly what you asked, but that was something that we did with the ukulele program.
Well, in one of the series coming up, we're going to talk about Langley and what happened in Langley. And actually, Chalmers, I copied what you did. Imitation, right? It's the greatest form of flattery. I took what you were doing and did that same thing across the other coast of Canada. Do you know what? This is a great opportunity. I know you've sent along a clip of the Halifax kids playing on a pier. And I've got Eric queuing that clip up. Let's show the audience a little sample of the Halifax ukulele program and how you had kids playing. And you'll see the sheer numbers of kids on this pier in Halifax Harbor.
Okay.
We're going to get some sound here, Eric. Maybe not. We'll see if Chalmers, just take a moment and describe what it is that we're going to show everybody.
I'm going to chime in because I was there and I was a little kid, but Dad, you can too. You were there, yeah. National Film Board of Canada came to you, is what I recall, and they wanted to do something with these huge number of kids, and they pitched a few ideas. Anyway, this is what ended up happening. If we've got it, I'll just see if Eric's going to play it.
Not yet.
So they pitched you a few ideas, I think, Dad, and you were pretty busy at the time, I recall, and the guy kept coming to you from the film board and saying, we want to do this, we want to do that, and you were giving a few ideas, and then
he was trying to talk to me, and I was trying to run a music. I had kids all over the place, and I was doing things.
Hey, okay, let's see if it works. And that's you up on the podium there.
Yeah, there's Chalmers.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, sing. This is love, love is music, if you know what I mean. The people who believe in music are the happiest people I've ever seen. Clap your hands, stomp your feet, shake your tambourine. Lift your voices to the sky, for love to make you sing.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Well, Chalmers, that program that you had going in Halifax obviously lifted off and went across Canada. I know it ended up in Langley, British Columbia, which is where I was. Tell us a little bit about how you got that program into schools literally across our country.
Well, I started to get the attention of the media, and this is something that a lot of music teachers don't really understand, but if you don't sell your program, it's too bad, because you need to. And Peter, you are a master salesman. We know that, and you have done that beautifully. But it's an important part. And if you're going to, music is different from a lot of other subjects in that it's very personal and it's very dramatic. And it's just a deeper thing that happens to you when you do music than when you do some other things. And it lasts for a lifetime. And so it's worth selling. And so I got on television and radio real early and showing people what the uke could do. I had the top kids play, and I played, and we did this sort of thing. And then I decided to start doing workshops for teachers. And there's so many principles, we can't touch them all here. But one of the main things, you've got to have your students, you have to listen to your students. Now, a lot of people want the books on this and the books on that. If you just listen to your students, you'll most likely be successful if you really listen to them, because the young ones haven't learned how to lie yet, for one thing. And so they just tell you the way it is, and they'll say anything to you. And instead of being offended or what, just listen to them and pay attention to what they're saying, because they as a group end up with all the answers to just about everything. So I try to get teachers to do that. Instead of just because you're the biggest one in the room doesn't mean that you know the most. Listen to what the kids have to say and then start teaching the music. So this is what I did. And I spoke about this at workshops, and I demonstrated how you do all kinds of things like that with the instrument, with people, and people started to come to these workshops. And I ended up doing it. Actually, I taught workshops in every province of Canada except Manitoba. And I did a little bit of teaching in Manitoba, but I didn't do ukulele there. It's the only province I didn't do that in. But right from Newfoundland to Victoria, we did ukuleles, and we had a lot of them. And at the peak of it, we had, according to one newspaper report, approximately 50,000 kids playing ukulele. It's a lot of things. Now, that doesn't mean everybody was a virtuoso, but the point is, this was a big widespread program, and this is what you asked me. How did we do it? I did it with workshops locally. And when you got old enough, you started being, after you graduated from UBC, you were recommended to me by Cam Trosdale, who was one of your professors, and he was a concertmaster in the CBC Radio Orchestra, among other orchestras, very excellent musician, and he saw the good things about a ukulele, and he learned to play ukulele. By the way, we still are very good friends, and I talk to Cam every week. He's in British Columbia, and I'm here in Nova Scotia. Anyway, Peter, you understand that. So this is how it went nationally.
Wow. Well, you know, obviously I was able to benefit from that because Cam, of course, taught the program at the university, which I took and had a chance to then be involved in teaching out in British Columbia together with yourself and Bonnie Smith and others out here. But it was really interesting because, of course, a family member, Lorna McPhee, was my first teacher out here. And as I look now, and this is kind of a segue into talking to Mel, you've actually managed to get your family involved. I know we've got Melanie here, but you've got two other children and, of course, Jean, and you've had them involved in the program as well. And maybe just touch on that a little bit.
Well, we started a class with my oldest girl, which was Suzanne. I think she was around five at the time. I think with Melanie's group, they were three or four. They were much younger, or some younger. And I worked with these people to get 10 people in the class.
And it's the parents, a violin class, though.
Sorry, violin. Yeah, I started them on violin. And so I taught. The parents had to come to the meeting. I did not charge them money for their lessons, but they had to come on Saturday morning early and buy a violin. And so I had all these kids, little class of 10, each time one of my children got to be that age. And at the end of the class, we'd play ukulele and we'd sing. And at first they'd just sing. And the very first thing they did was learn how to pick the violin case up and walk around the chair and put it back down and sit down again. I mean, they started from scratch, literally. But anyway, yes, I did this with each of the children. And with my own family, we had two pianos in the room, and we had string bass fastened to the wall so it couldn't fall, and a little stool beside us. I did not teach any of the kids string bass, but they all learned to play by wanting to. And so all the instruments were available. Creighton, my youngest, wanted to play drums right at the beginning. He didn't love the violin, and he didn't love the ukulele, but that was part of the price. You had to play all of them if you were going to do this thing. So anyway, yes, this is what we did in the family. Mel, you take over on that.
Well, Mel, let's talk about that. I mean, I already gave your list of credentials and your great accomplishments. How did ukulele fit into all of that for you?
Well, you know, we grew up in a city and everyone was playing, and we had this thing where we had started when we were three, and we were part of it. He was building it and we got to grow up in it, which was amazing. We thought it was pretty normal until, you know, we moved away and realized, okay, but that's not everywhere. But, you know, not just us, the kids in our city started on the uke in grade three or four. And then the next year got to start on string instruments or wind instruments. And the whole city got these opportunities. And a lot of musicians came out of the place. A lot of my friends grew up with us and our family, and we moved away and became professional musicians. And we still work together today, or we're, you know, some are producers, some are classical players, some are amazing engineers all over the world. And these people, we just had the benefit, you know, of this kind of program where our ears were developed, our ears and our singing first with our uke. And we had all of this ear training that went on to get the classical background as well. And it was a very, you know, a wonderful way to grow up. We were really lucky. And yes, we did have it in our family, but it was not just our family. So that was really neat too, because all of our friends got to join in. So a real community thing. And then for me, when I ended up living in Toronto, which is quite a ways away from where you are now, Dad, in Nova Scotia, at a certain point, I realized if I wanted my kids to have any of these experiences, I was going to have to make it happen. So that's what got me going eventually.
Yeah, you know, and of course now you've caught the teaching bug. You've had a great career as a musician that continues, and as a singer, a vocalist, a pro. Now you've taken on sharing that with other kids in the legacy of your dad. Tell us a little bit about what you're doing in Toronto.
Well, it's modeled after all the work you guys have done. And I'm lucky enough to have my dad on the end of the phone. And I've got my sister, who's a music teacher in Cape Breton, and my brother is nearby. And my mom, who was also part of this, she was a volunteer at my elementary school. She taught all the kids in my neighborhood. She was the one. And my dad mobilized volunteers as a force of a whole teaching crew. They were all doing it in their neighborhood schools, which was a big way to reach into the community. But when I was ready to start for my kids, because I really wanted them to have an experience, I talked to my dad and I said, I think I'm going to volunteer at the school. Here's what I think I might do. I have 10 kids. How does it sound to you? And he said, well, are you going to take them right through to grade 12? And I said, right, yeah. Yes, I am. Of course I am. Of course I'm going to take them to grade 12. And he said, good. Well, you can't start until you're ready to start and go right to grade 12. That's when you're ready to do it. So I took that to heart, and that's what I did. And so I had, like I said, it started with these 10 kids, and in the course of taking the first 10 to grade 12, it grew to about 900 kids. But, you know, that was the right idea. You can't do it as a, well, maybe I'll dabble around and see if I enjoy it. But you can't let the kids down. Once you start, you have to be there for them, and you need to know what you're doing. And I wanted to point out too, just the nature of what's possible with this program is we're talking about classroom teaching. I know lots of your listeners are probably doing one-on-one and private lessons, which is all great. And the pedagogy works for all of that. But some of the genius of the program and of Dad's program and his method is doing it in the classroom, because that's where you are in the school. But the techniques that he has to use the kids to help you teach them is where I really get a kick out of it, because I'll say to Dad, I'll hear things coming out of my mouth when I'm teaching, and I'll say, oh my gosh, that's my dad. And I'll say to him later, well, you know, I did this, and then the kids were teaching each other around the room. And he'll say, oh yeah, that's how I do it. I call it teaching by rumor. And he gives a little secret music something to this kid over here after class. Oh, let me show you a little fancy, you know, I'll show you this fancy thing. And that kid, before you know it, has shown 10 other kids. And he's like, and they do it for you, you know. And if you're watching, and like he said, when you're listening to your students and you're watching and listening, they will do all of that, the momentum. Teaching. The momentum that they create, because they've got the energy, they've got the passion. This is all new to them. So if you can harness that, and that's his genius, is harnessing that and enjoying it with them and then watching them run with it and learning from them.
You know, I'm going to also pay tribute to Chalmers, because that is actually master teaching. When you're able to take the synergy of a classroom, when you're able to take the ideas of the kids and have that become the culture that pushes the program forward. I mean, we've all had, you're getting it now, Melanie, with some of your students. Chalmers and I can both point to students, you know, James Hill, Mark Luongo, Paul Luongo. We can talk about great students that we've had who actually did the teaching for us, because they were able to piece together ideas we might not have thought of. And you've both said it so beautifully. So you've got it going in Toronto schools right now, Mel.
Yeah.
How did you get into the school so that you could have students in front of you to be able to teach?
Yeah, it was tricky because my example was my dad, and he was in the school board, and he was the supervisor for working with the city and on the board and in the board, and that was a really smart way to do it. That wasn't something I was going to be able to do, so I volunteered. I volunteered and did one class, and I spoke with one principal. It just started like that, and I said, you know, would you permit me to volunteer for 30 weeks this year? I want to do a little class. And this person didn't know anything about music, didn't know anything at all about Halifax program. This was a total person, you know, it was all new to them. But they believed me that I knew what I was doing, luckily, and I was given the opportunity. So I took it. And that's how it started for me.
In one school?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, how many schools is it? You said 11 earlier, yes?
Well, we're more in the 30-ish somewhere. I don't know.
Okay. So you can't be doing this all yourself.
That's right. So then I remembered, you know, I'm back to Dad. I'm calling Dad on the phone. I'm going to, you know, this is going to kill me. How will I do this? All the schools want it. So he said, well, you've got to train teachers. Where are all your teachers? You've got to train them up. So I was really lucky. I had kids who grew up in the Halifax program who were now professional musicians in the Toronto area. And some like me who now had kids, they weren't going on the road. They didn't want to be touring around the world. They want to be home. They want to pick up their kids after school. But maybe they could teach a lunch hour program once a week. So I started training my people, and I was really, really lucky to have some amazing players who grew up in Halifax and knew what it was all about and just wanted to be part of it and wanted their kids to have the opportunity, so that we were bringing our own kids into it and then spreading throughout the communities here. And that's kind of how it's been growing.
Wow. And in terms of a program, what is it that you're actually having the teachers present to the kids?
We do 30 weeks. So we start in October, a little bit after school starts, and we meet with our kids once a week. They have one lesson a week. It's either lunch or after school. And we're doing the ukulele in the classroom method. And it's what I grew up doing. It's what Dad and James Hill have revamped and reissued in their books. And That's the program. So by the end of their first year, it's 30 weeks, so that they're playing by the end of their first year, they're singing and playing and reading, starting to read or reading. You know, they're at different zones at the end of first year. Some are and playing by ear like crazy. So, you know, all of those components, and they're performing. That's the other element.
It's huge. Chalmers, it must make you absolutely feel wonderful to hear how this legacy has continued with Melanie now doing really an offshoot of what you started.
It's pretty exciting, yes, to see this. And I mentioned earlier about listening to your students. If you can really think about that, if you're a teacher and you really start doing that, it solves all kinds of problems for you, because it doesn't mean that they know a whole lot of things, and you use psychology on them. That thing Melanie mentioned about having the kids take something. I would just get what I thought was the smartest kid in the class over in a corner, and I would be shown something, and I would just take it, and I'd go like, we'll say something simple like that. And I would show him, and then he would try it. And then the kids would start crowding around, and they said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Teach him something, and it's too hard. Can't do it." I said, "There's no way. No way I can do that. No way he's going to ever do it. So just forget it." So then I leave. And the kids all go to him, and they say, "What did he show you?" He becomes terrific. He gets about, he's just like a balloon blowing up. And he says, "Oh, it was this." And he says, "It sounded like they were going faster." And then some smart kid will try it fast. And anyway, you just leave that alone. It's just like planting something in your garden. And then about 2 or 3 weeks later, I'll be doing something, and I'll hear this lick. Yeah. And I stop the whole class. I said, "Wait, whoa. What did you do?" The kid thinks he did something bad, you see, for a second. Yeah. And I said, what was that? I just heard you play. And he kind of acts like he's shy and everything, and he tries it. I said, "That's fabulous." I said, I was thinking of doing that with the group, but I couldn't really do it.
Yeah.
And then I hear someone else doing it, because they can't let him have all the credit, because they're doing it. And I said, "Amazing, let's do it." And then we just go right into it. And I did the same thing, you know, hundreds of times. And I did it with the teachers, too. The thing is, it's a lot more palatable to take it that way than to have someone forcing it down your throat.
Yeah. You know what, Chalmers? Yeah. I learned it from you. It's exactly what I would do for years. And it pays off every time, because the kids set the culture. You know, you're a genius, sir. You're a genius. And you know, one of the greatest, most heartwarming things that ever happened in my life as an educator was going out on recess duty and hearing the kids in the little alcove showing each other what they were doing.
Exactly.
On the uke. You know, instead of kicking a soccer ball, they're out there. Nothing wrong with kicking a soccer ball, but they're out there playing the uke and just fantastic. So, Melanie, how are you affording to do all this? I mean, are you charging the kids $1 million a year for this? Because it, you know, sounds like it's very worthwhile.
All right. Well, again, the example I had was that it was free for the whole city, because it was free. That was amazing. So that posed a problem for me. So as I started to have other teachers involved, I couldn't very well ask everyone to just, "Why don't you volunteer at your kid's school?" So I started raising money, and it, a few years ago, became a registered charity. So now I raise the money so that I can afford to pay teachers properly and have great teachers who stay with the program and want to be there because they're treated well, but also they're always training and getting better and better at what they do. And we raise the money so that I can offer it to schools either free or very close to free, very, very low.
Can you talk a little bit more about that? Because I know there are going to be people out there going, "How do I access dollars?" And we're going to have listeners from around the globe listening to this. What tell the model that you used here in Canada.
Well, it's, I don't know. I'm learning myself. I'm, like my dad said, if when we do something musically and we try to do it at a very high level, I use that as a chance to let people know about the program. And I'm really lucky to have some musician friends like Jan Arden or other bare naked ladies who stepped in and said, you know, we believe in what you're doing. And that helps me to have someone step in who may be working at the Scotia Bank or Toronto Bank or some bank that says, we have a community fund and we believe in what you're doing, because we saw that when the bare naked ladies told me about you. So, you know, it's always a balance of trying to make sure people know what you're doing so that they can say, you know, we love music and we want to contribute. So it's an ongoing job, and I certainly don't have the answers. I just am going about it the best I can, because I'm going to keep it going no matter what. But yeah, it's fundraising is a whole other thing. And that's a charitable organization discussion. But for me, it's been very important to reach as many kids as possible. And I want it to be something that all of the kids who might have interest can do. If they want to be there, I want to have them in the program. And that's the other great thing about the UK is that all of our kids own their instruments. And I learned that also from my dad in his program. We don't just have a set that we trade around and use in one room. The kids have their own instrument, and even if they're buying it for $5, they own it. They put down their $1, they own it, and they have it at their house. They can practice. We give lots of practice advice. We have all kinds of support for parents so they can learn how to help practice. So if your kids, you know, if our kids know how to practice, then they're on their way. So that's a big focus of the program too, is keeping them practicing and enjoying playing. But if they don't have their own instrument, they can't do that. And a ukulele is something that is accessible that way. It's not that much money. And if someone can only pay $5, we can come up with that extra money to make sure they own their instrument. And I mean, Dad can speak about that too, but that's, just a huge thing to also trust a kid with their own instrument means a lot to the child. And the parents also feel more invested, even if it's $5. They paid for that. So let's hear something. Let's play something for your grandmother. You know, everyone gets a little more encouraging when they have plunked down a couple bucks. So we use that to our advantage, and but not to be exclusive. It's always inclusive. We make sure everyone, there's equitable access is the main thing. And if they can't afford it, we'll find a way. There's always a way.
Yeah, Chalmers' model again of having the kids own their instrument, we used in Langley. Every student that was in the Langley ukulele program owned their instrument, and we made sure that we found ways if we needed to help and support kids that way. And I would say with adults too, adult players. Chalmers, you want to say something about that?
Well, that's just, it's a fundamental thing. It's very important. And you can help people own something if you want to. And that's the principle of it. But the psychology is that it's theirs. Mm-hmm. And they have a commitment to it. And mm-hmm. and that's really what it's all about. The a thing that Melanie just skipped over a little bit because she has to, hasn't got time to go into things, is practice. And when the kids, I used to say to the kids, well, how much did you practice? And they would try to think of a number that would be believable. And they would tell me something about, you know, and you'd have all these fictitious numbers about how much they practice. And I said, well, that's great, because I've just talked to five or six of you, and every single one of you is practicing. That's terrific. I would like somebody to volunteer to show me 1 minute of practice. Would you be willing to do that? And they become very shy all of a sudden about practicing for 1 minute. And I said, well, and I realized this when I was doing this. I said, so pay attention. I'm going to show you what a minute of practice is. And maybe that'll help you realize what you have to do. So I said, get your uke out and start going. And so I say like this, okay, now, are you ready? Start strumming. I want to hear a D chord. Everybody play a D chord. Okay, now play it faster. Okay, now play it faster. Make it into a D7. Okay, that's good. Okay, now let's hear a G chord. Okay, now make it into a G7. Okay, now let's go faster. Okay, it's good. Okay, now just in case you're wondering, we've done almost 20 seconds. anyway, I keep that up for a whole 60 seconds. Yeah. And I have them really tired out playing a few chords. And I said, that's a minute of practice.
Yeah.
So when you tell me that you did 20 minutes or 30 minutes, think about it. You know, having the uke in the same room with you is not practicing.
Yeah.
And of course, I play a lot of instruments, as you know, playing, jamming with me and so on. And I've done the same type of program with piano, functional piano, and I've done the same sort of thing with a lot of different instruments. I play 10 or 15 instruments, and it's something that you can never have enough time to practice all those instruments. But I wanted to say this one thing that somebody took. I was teaching when I was at university at a school, and the guy that was doing it, I had to leave. I couldn't stay working with him anymore because it was a problem. He didn't want the teachers playing with the students.
Oh.
And I said, well, you know, that's so backward. I can't conform to that. That's ridiculous. And you should always play with your students. And I can tell you this, and this is a true story. I've taught hundreds and hundreds of kids, and I can tell you that there are hundreds of kids that can play any of the instruments that I play better than I do.
Yeah.
And that is your, whether you're doing it or not.
Yeah.
And I love that. I love it. And I jam with them and I play with them. And that is the thing. You do not have to be the king of the castle and the best player. But you could be the best teacher.
Yeah.
But that's very important. I want to get that point out because a lot of people don't understand that. Recreational ukulele, as far as I'm concerned, doesn't exist. A six-week program on the ukulele, you're not doing it. You've got to do... I would say don't start your program until you can do at least 3 years.
Yeah.
And 3 years, you'll start to believe and you realize what you can do with those kids and get going and teach them all kinds of things. And that's what Mel's doing in Toronto. Yeah. And even now when people come to me for lessons, I teach a few people in my little studio over here. Well, people are staying with me because they're learning to play. They're actually playing music.
Yeah. Mel, do you want to pile on that?
No, it's just great. It's great. We talked a little bit, and I'll just touch on this one, but we talked about owning your instrument, but it's the same thing with owning your music. And Dad and I talked about this earlier when we were preparing. The whole job is that your students will own the music. It's not about you showing stuff and proving what you can do and what you learned at music school. They have to own the music so they can have their instrument. They own it. They own their music. They're writing their own music. They're playing the songs they love. They're in the corner during recess, owning it and playing it with their friends, taking it home in their room or playing it at their you know, holidays with their family. That's owning the music and owning their instrument. And that's really, really important. That's the goal.
Yeah,
and that's what Suzanne's doing, grade two, grade three. She's teaching them how to write little pieces of music. Yeah. And then they play it, and then they expand it. And this is what she's doing in her school system in Sydney. Yeah. Terrific, terrific stuff.
Yeah, that's the oldest daughter, Suzanne. Outstanding. Yes. Now, I have to do a couple of disclaimers here really quickly. Going back, Melanie referred to the Bare Naked Ladies. That's a band, just in case anybody's wondering out there. And secondly, Chalmers alluded to a D chord, and I don't want you to spend more than a minute on this, but Chalmers in Canada, in Langley, across Canada, Nova Scotia started it, it's D6 tuning, which is not the standard tuning across the world, but it's the tuning you use. Can you just touch on why it is that we started in D6 tuning?
Well, all the great teachers in Hawaii back in the beginning, by the way, I spent a lot of time in Hawaii teaching in the schools in Hawaii. Played with a D tuning, and I studied a bit with Herb Ota in Hawaii, one of the finest musicians in existence and one of the best ukulele players ever.
Mm-hmm.
Terrific man. He used to use different tunings, and he told me something about that. But the D tuning, by the way, I spent time talking with Arthur Godfrey and a whole lot of people that knew something about ukulele. He knew more about people, I think, than ukulele, but he was a terrific musician too. But the D tuning is a brighter sound and a better sound. Now, I'll teach you in any key. I don't care. That's irrelevant. That's a wrinkle. But if you want to do D tuning, that's fine. If you don't want to do D tuning, do C tuning. That was to make it, to sell it better, and to make this easy chord easy. And where's my picture?
I can't. Yeah, you got it. You got it. We got you.
If you put your finger like that and you call it C or D, really doesn't matter. It's the sound. You get a little brighter sound with the D tuning, and I like to do that. Plus, it links up very nicely with the guitar and the string bass, which are two more instruments that go great with ukulele playing.
Yeah, well said. We've spent about an hour here, you guys. This has been just an absolutely great kickoff to our webinar series. Mel, how can folks get a hold of you?
Oh, there, uschool.ca. There's the website. If you want to send me a message or learn more about the program or get some support for things you're doing, we've got tons of resources and I'm very available. So send me a message. Love to hear from you.
Good. And Chalmers, I know that folks can look you up online, but why don't you tell folks what you're up to on a regular basis through your week?
Well, I have a little studio down here, and I teach a few people, not very many lately because of the quarantine and everything. But basically, if somebody wants some lessons and they're interested seriously, I will make an arrangement with them that they can work with me. And I teach quite a few different instruments. I took clarinet up after I retired, and I really like the clarinet very much, and I have a lot of fun with that. And I play it with my band. I play in a lot of seniors' residences, and I do this sort of thing. But I teach, basically, I very seldom turn down a teaching job. But, I have to make sure someone's serious. But if you have questions about it, I don't mind spending some time with you if you're interested in getting in touch with me. I'm not advertising a big thing, but I do have a website, and you can get in touch with me. I'm even in the phone book. So.
And you can email me if you want to get a hold of him. Yeah. That works, yeah. Too. But, they're still coming from all over the world to meet this guy, Peter, and get lessons. He's got, not during the pandemic, but they're coming from all over. It's always interesting to find out who's made the pilgrimage to Nova Scotia to meet you and work with you. And on top of his weekly gigs that he's doing with his band, he's still playing. You just played badminton this morning. He's a sports guy on top of it. So just,
I love it.
Just throwing that in there because it's fun.
Well, it's been an honor through my life to be able to be connected to you, Chalmers. You are very much an inspiration, and I appreciate you so much. And Melanie, I'm just enjoying that we have now connected and that we have a chance to do something and stay connected across the country. Our two families have great respect for each other, and it's wonderful to see across a continent that the ukulele has bound us in the way that it has. It's really awesome. Really awesome. I want to thank you on behalf of the NAMM Foundation for taking part today. I want to remind everybody out there, the series will continue. We have a total of five. This was number one. We're going to be meeting Roy and Kathy Sakuma and Jake Shimabukuro next month. We're going to talk about their program in Hawaii. Langley Ukulele Ensemble will be featured in May. And James Hill is going to appear with me and with us here in June. And then finally, we're going to wrap up with a series that features several hosts of festival events. Each last Thursday of the month from now till July, we'll be here sharing information about teaching and learning to play the ukulele. Again, Chalmers, Melanie, thank you. Be well. To everybody out there, stay well. We'll see you next month.
Thanks, Peter.
Thanks a lot, Peter. Take care.
You too.